winning Motor Trend Truck of the Year 3 times in a row? That had never been done before. Then again, neither had a 12-inch touchscreen or 1,000 pound-feet of torque. Never been done before. It's just kind of our thing.
Flames Post Game Live is on the air, brought to you by Ram Truck, the Motor Trend winner of the Motor Trend Award for the 3rd year in a row. Brendan Parker, Matt Stajan alongside, and Calgary Flames win their 2nd straight over the Vancouver Canucks, 5-2 the final here tonight. So over the course of these back-to-back games at home against the Canucks, they outscore them 8-2 and end up getting 4 huge points. And as we know, in this way that the schedule's set up, when you can gain some ground on your opponents early in the season, makes a huge difference, and they were able to do that over the course of tonight.
Yeah, these games are huge because you just can create some separation between yourself and and the teams you're playing against in your division, and you never know what's going to happen, you know, as the season goes on, with injuries or with COVID and having to miss practices or guys missing games. We saw it with Vancouver missing JT Miller for a few games, so it's important to get these points and put them in the bank because they all count the same.
Well, and now they get some time off, and we'll talk about that as the show rolls on, the fact that there's 5 days now in between games, which is rare. In fact, it's the longest break in between games for the Calgary Flames this season. But let's first go back and look at what happened in this hockey game and take you through the highlights. Starting in the first period, which was a heavily dominated Vancouver Canucks period, the Calgary Flames able to escape it with a 1-0 lead, but it was the Canucks that got on the board first. Jake Virtanen from a long range, but ends up getting a deflection, beating Markstrom.
Yeah, and it's a good play by Virtanen, and you knew Vancouver knew they had to get traffic in front of them if they want to score on them. That's the only way they really have been able to score on them both nights, so that's what they did here. They threw the puck at the net, but the Flames were lucky to get out of that period only down by one.
Yeah, we'll show you some of the Markstrom saves coming up in a little bit, but it's 1-0 after one, and now in the second period, it's a completely different perspective, and it starts with Johnny Gaudreau, Sean Monahan, and Dominic Simone on that line.
Yeah, a nice give and go with Johnny and Monty. Monty created the turnover down low, and Johnny made no mistake putting that one in, and it just created a ton of momentum and kind of flipped this whole game around in the Flames' favor.
And so it continued. Now Michael Backlund, Milan Lucic, Josh Levo, a new look line with Dylan Dubé out. Some things kind of moved around, and Michael Backlund gets his first of the season.
Yeah, just following up the play, and you know, the Flames are crashing and banging the net there. Lucic's in front, and Backlund picks up the garbage and makes no mistake. So you take any goal you can get. It's a big momentum swing right there, and nice to get the lead.
So that's 2-1 Calgary at that point, and then just a few minutes later, this was in the dying seconds of that middle frame, a 5-on-3 power play, and for the 3rd consecutive game, the Flames score with the man advantage.
Yeah, and it's great awareness here knowing the clock. This puck went in with under 1 second left, so you see Johnny make a quick pass through the seam to Lindholm, who made no mistake, but you saw the urgency of them putting pucks in the net there with under 5 seconds left, and they get rewarded.
Third period, you kind of, we talked about it in the intermission, you had to kind of keep it going and for the Calgary Flames not give Vancouver any life, and they were able to do that. Played in their end for most of it, and then Mark Giordano gets rewarded later in the period with his first of the season, teeing off here.
Yeah, it's a big shot from Captain Gio. Love to see him score. Just everything's easier. You saw a lot of the Flames have scored their first goal throughout the lineup. They have a lot of different goal scores through the first 3 games, which is nice. And it's always nice when the captain scores.
Absolutely, and it gets him feeling pretty good as well. Vancouver did get one back here. This one was actually a shorthanded marker. Tyler Myers ends up getting credit, goes off a stick and in, beats Jacob Markstrom. They would press. They pulled their goalie with about 4.5 minutes left and got a couple of chances, but with the net empty, Rasmus Anderson with a bouncer, I guess you'd call this thing, a seeing eye shot from long range goes in.
For sure. If you ask him, he meant to do that.
Absolutely.
He knew where it was going the whole time. So
never in doubt, never in doubt. So 5-2, the Calgary Flames beat the Vancouver Canucks here tonight. And, you know, maybe let's just circle right back to the start of what we talked about, because Jacob Markstrom was sensational when they needed him in the first. Didn't have to rely on him too much until maybe the last 5-10 minutes of this third period. But, you know, as you kind of mentioned at different points throughout this evening, how big that is when you look back and see the fact that he kept you in this hockey game in the first period.
Yeah, it was huge. It easily could have been 3-4-0 for Vancouver. The shots were like 15-1 at one point in the first, and you know, he came up big. You know, I think, and it kind of took the sails out of Vancouver because they were flat the rest of the game. And you got to credit the Flames for that, but just to get the team to the second period within a goal, you know, that's just a big confidence booster. That's why you brought in a goalie like Jacob Markstrom, and you know, you're going to see 5 years of this, and he's a difference maker, and that's what happened tonight.
Yeah, there's a good chance there from Adam Gaudette, who was all over the ice in the first, and then as you mentioned, Flames kind of controlled the game from that point on. Shots were 20-4, I believe, in the first period, and then completely shifted back towards the Calgary Flames, 16-4 in the first for Vancouver, 20-3 in the second period for the Calgary Flames. So a complete shift, and you know, we were talking about it in the first intermission about just trying to find a way to shift momentum some way, somehow. And you know, I think Matthew Tkachuk mentioned it the other day, just about they're pretty good on the bench in terms of, you know, building each other up, whether it's the block shots, the things you'd normally get from the crowd, but finding your own emotion. And they kind of got that from a shift in that early part of the second period from Monahan and Gaudreau that didn't score, but maybe it led to turning it around.
Yeah, and we're seeing a lot of line juggling. We see the pairs and the duos, we like to call them, on the forward lines, but yeah, we're seeing a lot of guys mix and match throughout the lineup. But Johnny and Monty came out, and I think Tkachuk was on their line,
yep,
for that
Tkachuk,
shift,
yep.
And it,
I think we got it here,
and it just kind of, you know, turned the tables around and with momentum in the game, and you'll see this. Coach Ward will do this because Tkachuk doesn't penalty kill. Lindholm does, so Lindholm's going to see more ice time in different spots, so they're going to try and spot Tkachuk in different areas and times in the game with different guys, and this boosted the team and got them going. So it's been big, and you know, I think early in the season we're seeing it throughout the league, power plays, special teams, penalty kill. The teams that are getting off to good starts in those areas are going to have a ton of success. And you know, for Vancouver, you know, they've been terrible on their power play and penalty kill, and because of it they've lost three in a row. And at this point in the year, that's the difference. It always is the difference, but early in a season where teams are trying to find their way, it's all the difference.
Well, and you're coming off a game where you didn't score a goal, and you're trying to find some offensive spark. The special teams can be a way to do that, but they were 0-11 coming into tonight, and obviously don't get one on the man advantage here this evening as well. Get one shorthanded, I suppose you can kind of build off that. But as you mentioned, it makes such a difference when you're feeling the confidence on that man advantage, and the Flames on the other side of it, completely the opposite. They're feeling it right now with that man advantage.
Yeah, and their penalty kill's feeling it, and their goaltender's feeling it, their power play. So you know, things are rolling for them, and you know, they got 5 days off now, like you said. So you know, they got to keep working at it, keep that momentum, because you got the Leafs coming in who are also you know, they rely on their special teams a lot, and hopefully you can kind of keep building on this.
What when you start to look at 5 days here in this early part, there's no exhibition games. I think we've seen that times, you know, the trickle-down effect of not having those reps. You know, what can these practice days now over the next few days allow the Flames to work on and fine-tune here?
Yeah, it's going to probably be, you know, get some rest here. I think, you know, it's kind of a shock to your system when you jump right in and you play three games, your first three games of the year with no preseason. So you get a little rest, and then you go right back at it. I'm sure they're going to, you know, get some skating in, you know, work on your special teams, your breakouts, your neutral zone, just little details of the game that need to be ironed out. You just watching the games, I think every team, you know, needs to iron a lot of that stuff out. So gives the coaches an opportunity to do that, and you got to take advantage of it, because I don't think they have many breaks like this at all the rest of the season. So you know, hopefully they put good use of it and come in on the weekend and can kind of keep going where they've left off.
Yeah, and that'll day off on Tuesday, and then three practice days, I think, and not until Sunday they see the Toronto Maple Leafs, which I guess will be an early divisional leader type of matchup, because Toronto's off to a good start, and obviously the Flames now have five of possible six points to start their season. I believe Michael Backlund is just settling down in the chair there, our one up, one down studio, and is he ready, guys? Yeah. There he is. Oh, yeah, look at that. Michael Backlund, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, dude. Maybe just first of all, let's just go back to that first period, the transition from the second. I mean, did you guys feel fortunate in some ways to only be down one, and what was said in the locker room to turn things around going into the second?
Yeah, for sure. Marky did a great job for us in the first. We're kind of a little bit on the heels. And we knew they were going to come, but they made a hard push. They got an early penalty, power play. And they got some pressure on us, and we had a hard time to get out of it. But we had a good talk in a second, you know, just said, you know, we got to do what Winnipeg did to us in Winnipeg, and going to come out here and show that we're the better team. And I thought we did that right away in a second.
So, Bax, did you stand up in the middle of the room and give a big rah-rah speech after the first?
Nah, everyone chipped in, so It was everyone in Wardo saying a few words.
When you talk about that second period, there was a shift, a couple of shifts there before that first goal went in. But when you kind of look at sustained pressure, is the bench kind of feeding off that? I know guys have kind of talked about generating that energy from within and from the bench, but did you kind of feel that starting to mount in the second there?
Yeah, for sure. I thought we had some good shifts there, and Johnny, Monty, and Dom had a really solid long shift there and finished off with a big goal. So, and like you said, a few shifts before there, we had some good pressure. So we thought it was building and it was coming, and we're starting to feel better by ourselves, and it was big for us to get those three goals during the second.
Bax, how nice is it to score that first goal? I know early in the season, you guys have had a lot of guys score their first in the first three games. So it's nice to see that through the lineup. But just tell us how nice it is to get that first one out of the way.
Yeah, it's always nice to, you know, take away that zero in protocol. I mean, it feels even better when it's a big goal. You know, take a 2-1 lead after we just talked about, had a tough first period, starting to take over the game, and that felt extra really good because it was a timely goal.
Yeah, I was celebrating. I don't know if you heard me in the crowd, but I was going wild at this end.
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that.
You probably heard him. You probably did hear him.
Oh, yeah.
What about, we talked about special teams, but, man, you guys must feel confident when you get that opportunity to get out there and just the way you're moving the puck around right now. You know, what does that do for the group when you do get the chance to go with a man advantage?
Yeah, both groups have really good swagger right now, good confidence, like you said. It's great to come off with a good start in the power play and early in the season, and the PK as well. But the power play's been really good. And it definitely helps the group to create some momentum. I mean, it's not easy to score every time, but if you create some chances and some momentum, definitely helps the 5-on-5 game and the whole team to move forward. And I think that's what the power play's done, except for that bad turnover I made and they scored. Other than that, I think the power plays create a lot of momentum and energy for us.
Does Rasmus still have the shot of the night there from 180 feet or whatever that was?
Yeah, he said he was just trying to clear it, but I don't believe him.
And also, are you guys going for the record for most coaches and trainers on a bench? Because I look at your bench, you guys have like 10 people behind your bench. I haven't seen that before. I think you guys are going for a record. How's that?
Yeah, it's good. I mean, I think they're all doing a good job. They know their roles. I think last year was a transition for them knowing who does what. But I think this year it's been good. They all have different roles, and I think they've done a good job with that. But yeah, it looks a little pretty packed. Aussie looked a little lost there. Other than that, everyone looks good.
Yeah, he's representing the bald guy, so he's good. Enjoy your days off, Bax.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Good to see you.
Yeah, you too. Thanks, Bax.
Yeah.
Michael Backlund, he gets his first goal of the season. Some good stuff there from him post-game, and now we can look ahead to I don't know if the players look ahead to it, but there's some practice days coming up. But as you mentioned, there's some rest in there. Coaches probably look forward to practice days more so than players, but I don't know, maybe early in the season.
As an older, when you're an older player,
yeah,
you appreciate those days,
sure.
When you're a younger player, you just want to keep.
You just
want
to play. Yeah, absolutely. Especially when you're feeling it. All right, let's go right back to the podium now. Johnny Gaudreau and Elias Lindholm there.
Thanks, Sean. Johnny, about 5 minutes into the second period, you guys were getting outshot 17-5, and then there was a shift with I believe you, Matthew Tkachuk, and Sean Monahan that really sort of seemed to change the momentum. Did you sense that, and was there anything sort of said before that shift at all?
No, we kind of just hopped out after, I think it was maybe after penalty, I'm not sure, or maybe Dubes left. We got a shift together and created some good scoring chances and a lot of time in their zone, and I think the guys just kind of ran away with it there and had a really good second.
So you guys could feel that shift a little bit, because from there it was, I mean, I think you were out shooting them by the end of the period.
Yeah, obviously we needed some juice from something there. That first period wasn't great for us, and I think everyone kind of stepped up, all four lines there, or all the D, and kind of helped Markey out there and got a lead there, and yeah, big second.
Okay, we'll go to Cammy Koepke next.
Hey guys, congrats on the win. You kind of mentioned there that the first period was a bit lackluster. What was the message from Coach Ward between the first and second period?
Yeah, obviously we weren't happy with the the way the first period went. So we knew we had to bounce back, and we knew they would come in and be better to this game. So we were expecting that, but obviously they came with a lot of push, and we're kind of on our heels. So, but no, not much needed to be said. We're just, you know, knew we were playing bad, so we had to play better. So that was about it.
Okay, we'll go to Wes Gilbertson.
Guys, I know this is weird when you're sitting 6 feet from each other, but can I just get you to break down that goal with 0.2 seconds left in the second period, both from the point of view of the guy who made the pass and the guy who wired the shot?
Yeah, knew there wasn't much time. Razzy, I think, took a quick shot from the point. They picked the puck up off the corner there, and Lindy, I don't know, just saw him across the ice there and just put it past to him and shot it and scored, I guess. What did you say?
I agree.
Elias, I know you've known him for a long time, but between the shutout a couple nights ago and the way he kept you guys in it in the first, what do you think Calgary's learned about Jacob Markstrom over the past few days?
No, obviously we knew he was... He's a great goalie and a great guy, great in the locker room. So we knew what we were getting, but obviously the way the first period went, he kind of stole us, you know, a point or two there. We could have been out of the game there, but he played well tonight. And again, it's so he, for now, he deserves the contract.
We'll go to Darren Haynes.
It's a question for Elias, and no offense, sitting allowed. What's hotter right now, the PK or the power play?
Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to answer that one, but PK has been pretty good. I don't want to jinx it, but been really good. And you know, it's both has been really good for us so far, and hopefully that can continue, because that's how you win games.
Pulling up on the power play tonight, you didn't score with the first couple chances, I think, but Jeff said, if nothing else, make sure you generate momentum. Is that kind of what we saw tonight?
Yeah. Obviously, you know, when you play a team that you play recently, they know what kind of you're about in power play. So they definitely did some adjustments. So we had to do some as well. So, but overall, I think we scored two tonight, and you know, if you score two every night, you're going to win a lot of games. So overall, I think it was good.
Yeah, two more tonight for the Calgary Flames on the power play, and they are rolling early this season. It started in the first game in Winnipeg. They got that first one, obviously all three goals on Saturday night to provide the offense, and then right back at it again tonight. You heard Elias kind of smirking there. I mean, obviously, when you're scoring like that on the power play, that gives your entire group some confidence just in terms of what you can do on the offensive side.
Yeah, it's so important. If you just look at the stats and a lot of analytic people, you know, just look at the easy stat of when teams score a power play goal in a game, one goal, your odds of winning go way up. And the Flames have been scoring multiple goals a lot of these first three games. And you know, I think it's rolling for them. They got obviously the talent, and it's a well-rounded both units. I really like the setup of the first unit with the three righties. It gives you a lot of options and different looks that you can display, and they've been taking full advantage of it. So it's important early in the year, but it'll be interesting to watch as the season goes, because these teams are going to make adjustments. They're playing each other so much that there's going to be a lot of in-game adjustments between teams in their mini-series or as they play each other. So it's good to get off a good start, but it'll be interesting to watch the adjustments as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It's almost like a, you know, like a football team. You kind of have to change up the playbook a little bit from game to game as you move along throughout the season. Jacob Markstrom is there at the podium now. Let's listen into what he had to say third start tonight.
Jacob, it seemed like about 4 or 5 minutes into the second period, the kind of entire momentum of that game shifted. What did you see as the difference? What changed there?
Yeah, I mean, Vancouver came out, you know, flying like we expected, and they, you know, we couldn't really get anything going in the first, and then you know, in second, we're down by one, and we just kept grinding, and we stepped up our game a little bit and got some momentum with power plays and penalties, and we kind of kept the momentum throughout the end of the game, and great team win and great respond after not a great first, but you know, overall it's a huge game.
I know that you're trying to stop all the pucks no matter what is kind of happening, but when you're expecting that big push from Vancouver and then your team's kind of under siege early, what's kind of going through your mind as you just try and get the guys through to the other side of that?
For me personally, nothing. Just, you know, next shot, next puck, and trying to stay as calm as possible. And it's my job to keep the puck out of the net, and you know, you want to contribute as much as you can throughout the season, but throughout the games too. It's going to be periods where the other team, you know, the other team, they got a great team over there, so it's going to be times when they're going to have us on our heels, and they got one in the first, but you know, try to keep it keep down the score as much as I can. So, that's pretty much it.
Just one last one for me, if you don't mind. Are you cognizant of how that calmness kind of can exude and the impact that can have on the group in a time like that?
I'm sure it helps, but then, you know, even today in the first period, it was a couple of low shots that I tried to glove and, you know, popped out of my glove, and, you know, it wasn't really, you know, it was some rebounds that, you know, I would like to get whistles instead. Especially in the first, when we're running around a little bit and they have the momentum, you wanna get some whistle to get fresh guys in. And a couple times, I had opportunities where it kind of bounced on me. So, you know, still stuff to work on and to get better on. And you know, that's you wanna help out the team. And so there's stuff to get better at for sure.
Okay, we'll go to Ryan Pike.
Hey, Jacob, out of curiosity, on that first goal against, how much of the shot did you see? Because it seemed like with all the traffic in front, it would have been really tough for you to track.
No, I got a pretty good idea where it was going, and then, you know, a little unlucky deflection, and it's in the back of the net. That's how you score in this league. You get bodies to the net, and, you know, unfortunately, I got a little deflection. I went in, unfortunately for us, but I mean, that's kind of, you know, those dirty goals. That's when you go to the net, you get rewarded.
Okay, we'll go to
Eric Francis. Jacob, Elias Lindholm just said that it's official. You deserve the contract that you got now. Does that mean a lot to you that he approves of the contract?
I don't know. We haven't done anything yet, so I wouldn't say that. It's obviously a great feeling to be here and know I'm going to be here for a long time. So there's a lot of hockey left to be played, and I'm enjoying every second out there on the ice, even if it might not show up, but because I try to stay as calm as possible, but you know, we're all having fun out there.
Thanks.
We'll go back to Wes Gilbertson.
Sorry, just one more for me, I promise. Jacob, you've been on the other side of it. Can I just ask you, when Johnny Gaudreau's feeling it the way he seemed to be tonight, what makes him so dangerous from the other side? What makes that difficult for the guy at the other end?
I don't know. I mean, he's a world class player, and when he plays with Monty too, and he's so good with the puck, and he doesn't get, you know, he's so poised and so good at stick handling, really close to his body, and you know, finding gaps around in and around the net. Even, you know, he's not the biggest guy in the league, but you know, he doesn't often get hit, and he finds spot in scoring areas. He put himself in good positions, and you know, today he got rewarded with a goal and some apples. So you know, it's great to see him going.
Any other questions for Jacob? Okay, thanks very much. We'll be back with Jeff Ward.
We call it the Ram 1500 Limited, but truth be told, there's nothing limited about it. Ram 1500, winner. JD Power Award for Best Driver Appeal.
Flames Post Game Live brought to you by Ram Truck, Brendan Parker and Matt Stajan. There we hear from Jacob Markstrom, who had another good night between the pipes for the Calgary Flames and earns his second win as the Flames get 5 of a possible 6 points to start their season. There is one note, though, on the injury front. We talked about the lines kind of changing out in the highlights as we rolled off the top, and the reason for that was Dylan Dubé left this game in the second period. He took one shot in the second period, didn't see him again the rest of the game. Not sure what his status is. No official update there, but obviously a guy that was off to a good start, too, so hopefully nothing serious there.
Yeah, hopefully not, because he's been rolling ever since the playoffs last year. He just seems to continue to get better and better. So we'll find out what it is. I'm guessing it's not really showing what he's favoring, but probably his groin or hamstring, we would guess, the way he's wincing there.
Kind
so we'll find out. But, just the line shuffled after that. You saw Mange go up and play with Tkachuk and Lindholm, and then Backs had some new line mates, and I think that just shows the depth that this team has, and
yeah,
they were able to overcome not just a tough first period, but an injury to one of the guys who's been really playing well for them.
And obviously, as we mentioned earlier, good timing in that they have some time off here, some practice days, but also some rest time if that is the case, and maybe get them back sooner than later. If there is some kind of injury. All right, let's listen in, maybe get an update here from head coach Jeff Ward on the status of Dylan Dubé, but just the rest of the game.
Thank you, Sean. Jeff, those first 25 minutes obviously weren't really what you guys would have wanted, but there was that one shift where it was Tkachuk, Monahan, and Gaudreau who went out there, and it was just sort of shot after shot, and it really, really seemed like from then on you guys were sort of firing on all cylinders. Did you feel that change in momentum at that point?
Yeah, absolutely. I thought we were outworked, outskated in the first period. I mean, Vancouver was really strong. They came out with a good hard push. We knew they were going to be better than the other night, and they were. And we were back on our heels for the whole period. And I give our guys a lot of credit. You know, we regrouped after the first intermission, and we came out and we found a way to tie the hockey game and then grab the lead. And that's a really good sign of growth for us as far as how we feel and how we react in the correct ways at key times.
Right now, Gaudreau, Lindholm, Tkachuk, and Monahan are sort of all producing offensively. Is it significant for this team that the guys who you rely on to score are scoring right off the bat?
Absolutely. I mean, your best players have to be your best players. If they're not, you don't have any chance in this league. All of our players have been contributing. That's what I really like about our last two wins. I mean, it was probably a pretty complete game for us the other night. Tonight we played two real good periods out of three. But, everybody's contributing, and we're liking a lot of the things that we're seeing right now.
Thank you. Okay, we'll go to Haley next.
Jeff, I think tonight was a really great example or display of, the playmaking and vision and just the skill that Johnny Gaudreau has, his ability to find seams and make plays. What did you see from him tonight, and what did you like about his game?
Well, I've liked a lot about Johnny's game all season. But you can see when he's feeling it a little bit, and, those are the nights when he can take a team on his back and carry us. And tonight he was feeling it, and you could see it just building. And he's such a tremendous player. He's got a special skill set. And I mean, the pass he made right at the end of the second period there to Lindholm for the for the 5-on-3 goal to stretch the lead to 2. What a play! I mean, there's not many guys in this league that can make a play like that. When those guys are going, it just makes everything fall into place for us. And tonight he was going.
We'll go to Ryan Pike next.
Hey, Coach.
Hey, Ryan.
The first period, at least from my vantage point, sort of felt very similar to that second period you had in Winnipeg. But do you feel like the experience you had with sort of a clunky period in Winnipeg sort of helped you make adjustments to sort of salvage this one, because it seemed like a lot of adjustments were made sort of midway through the game that allowed you guys to get your feet under you?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, if anybody's a football fan out there, you hear a lot on the English Premier League telecast. They're talking about quality. All soccer guys talk about quality. And I just didn't feel like we had quality in the first period. But we found a way to get it. And, the bottom line in this league is you have to ante up with effort. You have to ante up with compete. And I thought those two things gave us a chance to get in the hockey game. And then our skill was able to show. You know, it's without structure and without the work, it's tough to allow the skill to go. But when you get those things working for you, then the quality gets a chance to come out. And I thought, you know, those things really turned the game for us. And I thought we had some key moments where we were able to get ourselves back in based on the quality of our people, but more so from the compete and the work ethic.
Jeff, can you just talk about Markstrom in that first period? I mean, that was, for people in Calgary, that was like a Kiprasov-like period where he just absolutely held you in the game.
Oh,
can you talk about that?
Yeah, unbelievable, Eric. I mean, and so calm. You know, like he's in there, he's just playing. He gives you confidence as a team out in front of him because he's there. But, you know, he played phenomenally well all game, but the first period really good. But the save that, you know, one of the best saves for me was the one that he made on the last power play on the rebound. It looked like it was going in the net from where I was standing. They had us outnumbered at the front of the net, and all of a sudden the pad just came out. Huge save, and he had enough to kick it into the corner. He did everything that you want a goalie to do. He kept us in. He gave us a chance to win. And at the big moments when we needed the big save, he made it.
Lindholm said that he's earned his contract for now. Would you agree with that?
Well, it's a really good start, that's for sure. I mean, he's been great for us, and you know, I think the biggest thing is that he's fit into our room so well, and the guys have very quickly become very, very confident in front of him.
And last question, Dylan Dubé, do you have an update on him?
I do not. You know, he tried it. He tried it there and couldn't go. I was told by Kent at that point that he wasn't going to be able to come back. But it's being reevaluated right now, and I'll know more in the morning on it.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
We'll go to Salam next.
Hey, Jeff.
Hey, Salam. How are you?
Good. You just said the word confidence, and just from on ice standpoint, what does that confidence enable players to do on the ice? Does it mean defense maybe are more willing to pinch up in the play? What does that translate to from a pure hockey sense?
Well, I think when you're playing with confidence, you're in the flow of the hockey game. You know, there's times in a game where it seems like you're chasing the game all the time, but when you have confidence, you're in the flow, you're making things happen. It's a good feeling, and obviously without confidence, you don't have any sort of chance to be an effective player. But confidence can do an awful lot of things for you, and it comes in a lot of different forms. It comes from obviously having success on the ice, but you know, it comes from how you prepare. It comes from how your teammates feel about you. Confidence comes in a lot of things, and the one thing about our team that I really like is that they feed the confidence level of our guys. Like, there's nothing right now that goes unnoticed. If there's a shot block, the guys are talking about it. If there's, taking a hit to make a play, the guys are talking about big save, a big goal. Like, all those things are valued and they're noticed in our room. And when you're a guy who, does those things, those thankless jobs, but they add up to wins. And, when your teammates recognize you for those things, it makes you feel good. It gives you confidence, and then you're able to go out and just play. So, a lot of the things contribute to it, but without it, you've got no chances in this league to be successful.
All right, there's some post-game thoughts from Jeff Ward. Just at the end, they're talking about confidence, and I think we just kind of added it up. What is it, eight or nine guys with a goal already to start the season?
Yeah, eight guys already have their first goal. And yeah. It's more than that when you add points in. So that's in the first three games, you spread the scoring out like that, and your top guys are feeling it. You're feeling good about yourself.
Yeah, that's a good start to the season for sure. And now they'll get some time to work on it. 5 days off in between games, the longest stretches. They've got the Toronto Maple Leafs coming up on Sunday, but some good time to practice in between. Thanks for doing it.
Yeah, good to be here.
Toronto Maple Leafs up next for the Calgary Flames. As for tonight, well, was it the start they were looking for in this hockey game? Trailing Vancouver 1-0, getting outshot, getting outplayed, but everything completely shifted around, maybe according to a Michael Backlund speech or everybody altogether, one way or another. They figured it out in between periods and came back out with a strong second three goals, and then eventually finishing it off into a 5-2 victory. Calgary Flames now 5 of a possible 6 points to start the season, and welcome the Toronto Maple Leafs for the first of back-to-back games coming up on Sunday.